All right. So today we're going to talk about Krishna's chart because it's Krishna's birthday. So I bet you expect that we will put a chart on the screen. You know, 12 houses and signs. And we will. I won't disappoint. But the first thing that you should understand about Krishna's chart is that it's from a very long time ago. And we don't know what his chart is. However, we have a long-standing tradition about what it is. The difference is like the difference between having your birth certificate or having had the people in your family tell you stuff about your birth. We have a birth certificate of sorts for Krishna, and I'll read it to you, which is a statement from Padma Purana, Bhagavad Purana. But it's very old, and in those days astrology was done quite differently. The Vedic astrology was actually Vedic in the time when Krishna was born. We can do scientific archaeology, and people have done it, and unfortunately I don't know, I don't have their names memorized, but several scholars have done rigorous astronomical archaeological work to date the Mahabharata. The Mahabharata is another very old book in which Krishna is the main figure. In other words, you can do this by the observations. Like, you know, the famous thing that I learned when I was in school was some Chinese guys, they said that a star blew up in the sky. And then because they said that, they could actually figure out the date of that document. So similarly, in the Mahabharata, there's a lot of stuff where people are saying the Saturn was over here while Jupiter was over there. And when you say that, then you can use software, you can use math to calculate when that could have possibly been. Because it could only have possibly been at one time if you have multiple things, certain things. So people have done this with Mahabharata, and they know that it is roughly 3000 BC. So we're talking about a birth chart today that is 5000 years old. So that makes like a Jesus Christ chart look very modern. It's more than twice the age. So 5000 years ago, in 3000 BC, they were not doing astrology the way that we do it today. At least it doesn't seem like they were, because they didn't leave records of it. So the first thing that we're going to do is take a look at the record that we do have. See what it does tell us. And you'll be surprised how much it does tell you. And then we will look at the tradition of what Krishna's 12 house birth chart looks like. All right. Thank you. All right, let's do this. So let me read you this statement. This is Bhagavata, 10th book, 3rd chapter, 1st statement. Atha sarva gunopeta kala parama shobhana Yarhivajana Janmarksha Shantarksha Grahatarakam. One second. We actually know a little bit more than this, but it's not immediately present in this book. We also know the season of the year in which he was born, and that's important. Because you can just infer the season because of when they talk about the weather. So, because there was a huge flood. And also they just mentioned the weather. All right. So, what does this say? The most important thing, or the most direct thing, that the thing that is easiest for us to grab onto and utilize right away, is Ajana Janmarksha. Yarhevanjana Janmarksha. You probably don't hear this name of a nakshatra in that, but there's the name of a nakshatra in it. Ajana Janmarksha. What arksha means is nakshatra. Or a star, or like an asterism or a collection of stars. Janmarksha is your birth star. Ajana Janmarksha. What does Ajana mean? What, I don't know about any nakshatra named Ajana. Is it, again, this is because in these ancient times, they didn't refer to the nakshatras with the names that we use today, believe it or not. They refer to the nakshatras by the names of the deities. This is how important it is to understand the deities of the nakshatra and forget all the rest of the nonsense garbage that you talk about with the nakshatras. Anybody know who is Ajana? Or it should be Ajana. But it's a play on word because it's Ajana Janma. Anybody know? Anybody know? What nakshatra belongs to somebody called Ajana? Nope. It is not a Jacobite. Good guess. Ajana is at least in there in a Jacobite. What does Ajana mean? It's not Arjuna. How you guys don't even know Krishna's birth nakshatra? You could even just pretend that you know this just by giving the answer. Jan means to be born. Ajan means unborn. Which deity is unborn? Yet born. What deity was created? So if you just leave the question the way I had it, what deity is unborn, you could say, well, it could refer to Brahma, Vishnu, or Shiva, or perhaps others. But mostly it would refer to Brahma, Vishnu, or Shiva, so it could be Ardra Nakshatra, it could be Shravana Nakshatra, or it could be Rohini Nakshatra, or maybe even Chitra. Probably not Chitra, because they would name it something else. Right, those are the primary three nakshatras for those deities are Ardra, Shravana, and Rohini. So it's probably one of those three. But like I said, it's a Ajana. Is it Ajana or is it Ajana? It's both. Ajana means somebody who was created, was born, and Ajana means not born. So it means one of the person who was not born normally. The deity who was not born normally. You guys know what deity that is yet? You don't know what deity that is. What deity was not born normally? In other words, didn't have mom and dad. doesn't have a mom and dad. He was born from a species which is both male and female. Anybody know? Brahma, somebody said it. Bardo, good job. Rudra doesn't have a mother or father, but he has a father. He's created from Brahma, the avatar of Shiva. So the word Ajana Janmarksha means Brahma's nakshatra. That means Rohini nakshatra. So we don't know what they exactly mean by Janmarksha. But for 5,000 years, people have been accepting that it means the nakshatra that was occupied by the moon. And that is 99% certain that that's what it means, because that's the way it's been used in the calendars ever since anybody can remember. Like, in other words, maybe it means that's the nakshatra that was rising. Maybe that's what they considered important. But probably it means it was the nakshatra of the day, because that was the calendar system that was in place. So, as you know, the nakshatra of the day means the soup du jour. The nakshatra of the day is the nakshatra that the moon occupies when the sun rises. So what we can do now with this actual birth chart that's already on the screen here is we can put the moon here. Let's put it here. In Rohini. So that's one thing that we know pretty certain about Krishna, that he's Rohini moon. What is the interpretation of a Rohini moon? What does Rohini mean? You should actually, let me grab this. Well, the Nakshatra Sutra is, for Rohini, is needs water to grow plants, and the meaning is it's very love oriented and fertile oriented and likes attention and therefore develops beauty to attract attention so that they can grow the plants. They attract the water so they can grow the plants. They also, it's very agricultural, right? Literally, Rohini is very agricultural, fertile. And then psychologically, it's very attractive and beautiful and pleasing. Artistic, beautiful, pleasing. This is a lot of horoscope. This is a lot of interpretation. You don't need a 50 billion page report to get important information about the person. This is the most important essential thing to know about Krishna. He's not a big Jehovah, Yahweh with a beard and a lightning bolt, nor a pitchfork, nor whatever the hell people think God should be carrying. He's Rohini moon, which means he likes your attention and he needs your water. He needs your love. He wants your love. He likes your love. He likes your focus. He likes your attention. That's why he's super beautiful and attractive and kind and gives the beauty to please the people that are paying attention to it. If you only know that about Krishna, you could actually go very far in any kind of yoga involving bhakti or Krishna. Because that is really all you need to know, that he's a Rohini moon and that that's his personality. And then when you actually, in our Bhagavatam streams, when I'm like 70 years old with a beard down to my knees, when we get to the part of the Bhagavatam that's going to explain about Krishna, it'll make sense that he's a Rohini moon. Right, so that's the one thing. You guys understand that? No, sacred vagina is Barney. So going back to this, so atasarva gunopeta kala paramashobana yashivajana janmaksha. Now they also say shantaksha graha taraka. So now they're saying thank you, Tini. That's the other thing. The literal meaning of Rohini is also very applicable to Krishna, because although born in royalty, he didn't live in royalty as a youth. He lived on a farm, and he dealt with cows and agriculture every day, all day. So it's also very Rohini to be a gardener, to be a farmer, to deal with flowers and milk, things like that. All right, so there's another bit of info in here. There's like shorthand info. Shantak, so this says Arksha Grahataraka. It's very tantalizing to an astrologer, because they're using very astrological terms. The astrological terms, you Arksha Grahatara and Kala. So you know this verse is about astrology. But then you kind of get like left hungry for the amount of information that they give. But I think that's because we tend to overeat. Anyway, what is being said in this last line is that the stars and the planets and the other things in the sky, and the, or you could take it like this, the stars and the planets and their configurations. Arksha can also mean the configuration of things in the sky. Actually, it's used that, that's probably the best way to describe what the word Arksha means, configuration of things in the sky. Because Tara means stars. Graha means planets. Shantaksha Graha Taraka Shanti. They're very nice. They're very peaceful. So this is probably some kind of a reference to the dignity of everything. Or the yogas of everything. Everything was peaceful and nice. Nothing was bad. Kala Paramashobana is another summary of that. The time, the birth time, the Kala, was Paramashobana. It was really, really the best. And Sarva Gunopita is another reference either to just the general quality of the astrology at that time, or to the dignity of things. They had all the good qualities, Sarva Gunopita. So that's what it's, that's the only thing, that's the birth certificate. It's a very old school birth certificate. There's other statements that I don't have available in Sanskrit from other Puranas that give some more details. So another detail which is certified is that the Tithi was Ashtami. So what's a Tithi? Tithi is basically a sidereal day. When you use a sidereal calendar, the stars and the moon are the main determinant of what month, what day, etc. So a tithi is like a way of saying what day of the month it is. So what you do in the Vedic calendar is you take a month, which is a lunation, right? You go from a full moon to a full moon, or a new moon to a new moon, depending on what you want to do. You go from one of the moon phase all the way back around to another. And it seems to me that the Vedic calendar was full moon to full moon, but and that's still the tradition followed in the south of India, but in the north of India, I believe they're doing new moon to new moon. Anyway, you take one lunation and you then divide that into two parts. So the whole thing is very beautiful, really. Just like we have a day which is a solation, right? You have a day and it's divided into a bright part and a dark part, a day and a night. So then the bigger unit is the month, the lunation, and that also has a bright part and a dark part. The bright part is when the moon is getting brighter or moving away from the sun. That's how it gets brighter. And then the dark part is the when the moon is coming back towards the sun. That's when it's waning, waxing and waning, those two halves. Then within that, you have 15 tittis, which we would probably call 15 lunar phases, but they're called tittis, not phases, because this is the for a calendar. So we use the phase of the moon to determine what day it is of the waxing or waning cycle. And then within that karna, within that titi, you have karnas or halves to the titi. And then there's smaller units as well, but they don't go to hours and they don't use days. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, that came later into India. Anyhow, I think in like Vishnu Purana, Padma Purana, or Harivamsa, elsewhere, there's two other facts given about Krishna's chart. And one is that it was the Ashtami, and the other is that it's Bhadrapada Masa. The month is Bhadrapada, and we can confirm that with Bhagavad Purana because it's rainy season when he's born, or it's like the tail end of it. So, knowing these things, we can figure out some more stuff. So take a look at this. What's an Ashtami? Ashta means eight. So Ashtami is the eighth phase of the moon. In fact, it's Krishna Ashtami, which is apropos. Because the dark half of the month is called Krishna. Krishna means dark, black. And the waxing half is called Gaura or Shukla. Shukla means bright. Gaura and Shukla mean bright. So bright and dark. So we know that Krishna's had a half moon in Rohini and a half waning moon. So you can look up in old texts to see how they interpreted waxing waning and how they interpreted Ashtami. And you can get more of a like horoscopic reading from just knowing that he has a half moon, a half waning moon in Rohini. So what is the nature of a person born in the Ashtami? His chart is so amazing. It's like off the charts. When you come down to the, like, I'm just thinking about the traditionally accepted chart too. Anyway, Ashtami is very, very compatible with Rohini. And that's one thing. And second of all, Ashtami is just very, very auspicious in general. Whenever you want to do anything and you don't feel like you are capable of knowing the right Muhurta or something, if you just do it on an Ashtami, on a half moon, you're in a good spot. Ashtami is very auspicious. It's very compatible with Rohini because the nature of a person born in Ashtami is very similar to the nature of a person born under Rohini. So they will be they're very good people. They're kind people and they're not otherworldly or impractical. They're worldly. They involve themselves in the sensual world. They get artistic and they get beautiful and they get creative. This Ashtami person. But they're moral. They have a moral quality to it. So they like to please people and help people. So that's Krishna, Rohini moon Ashtami. Then the difference between a waxing Ashtami, waxing half, and a waning half is going to be a simple quality to it. that the waxing half is extrinsic, extrovert, and the waning moon has introvert or intrinsic or internalized to whatever the titi and the nakshatra is. So if you have a person born as Krishna was with a Rohini moon, that's half in Krishna Paksha, in the waning phase, in the waning cycle, then you put all these parts together to realize here's a person who's extremely beautiful, extremely productive and fertile, extremely creative, extremely helpful and loving, very lovey person, but not very strident or not very exposed about it, kind of secret or quiet about it, not very demonstrative or announcative of it. So this is very important also to understand about Krishna. And there's one statement in Bhagavatam, I'm sorry, there's one statement in Bhagavad Gita where Arjuna is curious, like, how come it's not easier to understand Krishna? And Krishna says, because I'm not busy showing myself off to people, because I don't want to get in their way. They want to do the stuff that they want to do, and I don't feel like getting in the way of that. So he basically says, Naham Prakasha Sarvasham. And he says, I don't stand in the face of fools. People that don't want to see me, they don't have to see me. It's a very waning moon type of Rohini. A very waning moon type of Rohini. They are beautiful. They're fertile. They want your love. But there's no way in hell that they're going to chase you for it. If you're such a fool that you don't realize that they're the best lovable person for you, then that is your lost buddy. Sing a Lizzo song. Lizzo would, Krishna would get into Lizzo, I think. Because Lizzo's attitude towards love is very Rohini waning Ashtami, waning half moon. Okay, so what else we can figure out? Ashtami, it means a half moon. So if you know astronomy, you can figure out that half moon will only occur if the moon is 90 degrees to the sun, or 270 degrees to the sun. So if the moon is coming back to the sun, then it has to be 270 degrees. A waning moon. So in other words, if somebody tells you it's a waning half moon at point X, then they don't have to tell you where the sun is. You can figure it out where the sun is. There could only be one place where the sun could be if it's a waning half moon at point X. So if the Bhagavatam or the Puranas say that Krishna was born with the waning half moon in Rohini, we can figure out where the sun is. That's why we actually can know what month it was and what time of the year it was. And then we could say it's not just any half waning half moon in the year. There's 12 of them. It's this one that happened today. So how would you do that? Ooh, I thought I had this on the screen, but I don't. So what is a shape that has 90 degrees to it, 9270? That's a square, right? So just to make it simple and visual on the screen, let's just draw a square. Can you see this? Wow, you got a square all the way over here on top of my chin. Let us make it a little bit bigger. And let us put it here. So we're going to go backwards with this. So if we have the moon here, so let's theoretically say, and we'll put it in the middle of the chart. Let's theoretically say it's in the middle of Rohini. Then you know that the sun, or you don't know, but because Rohini is 13 degrees and third big, so if the text says it's at 13 degrees. If it's at Rohini, we know within 13 degrees of where it is. So we can get a general idea of where the sun must have been, even though they don't explicitly say. But that means it must be there. It could be late Rohini, which would then push the sun into Magga. Could be early Rohini, which might make it go a little bit back into Uttarapalguni. But this is what the configuration basically must be, to have a waning half moon in Rohini. So then you know that this person is Purvapalguni. I'll just inform you from the studies that he's not a Magga. He's Purvapalguni. Go ahead, look for Purvapalguni video on Victor Kara's astrology channel. Go ahead and read about Purvapalguni in the Nakshatra Sutra. Do you feel like you might understand Krishna now? You know, you're trying not to understand him because you don't think that it could possibly be. This person. What if Marilyn Monroe was always at her peak? What if Johnny Depp was always at his peak? Jason Momoa, that was their eternal person. Then they would have some kind of configuration similar to this. Sun and Purvapalguni. Man, Purvapalguni is the masculine Palguni. Sun is there. And Palguni is for sexuality, creativity, fertility. So, there's one other thing you can know from this information. This is called the yoga. The original yoga in Vedic astrology isn't Raj Yoga or any of these other yogas. What is the other ones like? Gajakeshari. Those yogas are medieval developments. The original concept of yoga in Vedic astrology is the yuki between the sun and the moon makes the yoga. So in other words, let me read you actually how you would calculate a yoga based on this. This is Hart Defoe. His book is quite good as like an encyclopedia, Light on Life. He's quoting from somewhere but not attributing his quote. But he gives a methodology for calculating this, the yoga. You add together the longitudes of the sun and the moon. If it's more than 360, you get rid of the 360. Then you divide it by the size of a nakshatra, which is 13 degrees, 20 minutes. And then whatever, you just make a whole number division. So if there's a remainder, you ignore the remainder, but you add one. You add one to whatever you get. Then you'll get a number between 1 and 27, of course, right? If you divide 360 by 13 and a third, you'll get 27 possibilities. So they're reflecting the nakshatra, the 27 nakshatras, into 27 distances between the sun and moon. This is how they used to do astrology. They had these 27 nakshatras with this spacing of 13 and a third degree, affixed to stars, and then they abstracted that same grid and they affixed it to the moon. Wherever the moon travels, it would be affixed to the moon, and the distance between the sun and the moon would determine which one of those things this point, this calculated point, would occupy. And they would not be nakshatras, they would be a different thing. Okay, so to do that with Krishna. You're just going to come up with, if we did this together, it's hard to say because how, we don't know the degree, but we know that they're 270 degrees apart. So let's just make our life simple and say 270 degrees, because that's what we would wind up with getting. Then if you divide 270 by 13, I hope that this is right because I didn't try to work this out beforehand, and it's the first time I've done this in 7 years. So you divide 270 perfect, yay. You divide 13 by 270, and you, let me do it again. 270 divided by 13 gives you 20 point something. So you ignore the point something part, and then you add 1 to 20, so 21. So Krishna was born with the 21st yoga. And then you would have to look up, you know, what were those yogas? Well, those are recorded. They're named Vishkamba Priti Ayushman Saubhagya Shobana Atikanda Sukarna Dhriti Shula Gandavridi Dhruva Vyagata Harshana, like that. Vajra, the 20th one is Shiva, the 21st one, it's very good, right? Like I said, if you're getting Ashtamis, you're going to get, it's a good titi, so you're going to have good yogas there as well. So the yogas that are possible around an Ashtami is 20, 21, 22. So that's Shiva, Siddha, Sadhya. And 23 even is Shubha. And you know those words probably are very good words. Shiva means very auspicious or peaceful. Siddha means very perfected. Sadhya means very progressive. And Shubha means very good-hearted, very good, very beneficial. So Krishna's yoga is Siddha yoga. Lol. the yoga between the sun and moon is called Siddha. So what is the nature of a person who's born with the Siddha yoga? Siddhi means that you get what you wish for. You get the sum total. You get the bottom line, you get the product. So Siddha means the person, not only do they get what they strive for, they produce what they want to produce. So in other words, successful. The person who is born with the Siddha solar lunar yoga is successful. So this is what comes up with Krishna. He's a Lizzo kind of sexy. Rohini Nakshatra, very loving, very needy, sensitive to love, attentive to love, very fertile, very productive, very juicy, very agricultural. He's Ashtami, so he's very kind-hearted and sensually astute. But it's a waning Ashtami. So it has not less of a hedonistic and more of a psychological and spiritual tenor. And it's not extrovert, but it's inductive. This is why his name is Krishna. This is why he's represented by the color black. Because the color black pulls everything in. It pulls all the light in and doesn't let anything out. And the yoga is Siddha. Means whatever he wants, he's going to get. And whatever he wants to produce, it's going to work out. He's going to produce that. So that's pretty awesome. It gives us a look back into ancient astrology the way it was done. All the people who are saying the stars are important for your destiny, therefore we should use a sidereal zodiac, they went one step too far. The stars are very important for your destiny. The stars, the literal stars, that's why you should use the nakshatras, which are the stars. and how do you use the nakshatras? Well, you better look back into these ancient books to figure that out, because it ain't 12 houses and all that stuff. It's this. Now, we can go further with this, and I can start to show you what is the traditionally accepted 12 house birth chart of Krishna. But let me preface that by warning you that there is a controversy to it. I would say this controversy didn't arise probably until the late 19th century or mid 19th century. 19th century? No, 20th century. The problem with the 12 house chart, the accepted 12 house chart for Krishna, like if you went to an astrology school in India, the example charts that they would probably give you would be Rama's chart and Krishna's chart. So those charts, the problem with them is you can't open up your Jayahora or Kala or Parashar's light and type in some date and get that chart. And this was one of the first things that I researched once I learned a bit about how to use astrology and what it was. I researched this a lot, and I confirmed that you can't get this chart. No matter how much history I surveyed, you never get this configuration to come up. Certainly not in the time of the Mahabharata war, where Krishna is historically recorded as being around. So that's a problem. The traditionally accepted of chart of Krishna is not astronomically verifiable. That's a problem for people. So people like, what's his name? B.V. Rahman. People like B.V. Rahman, probably he took his cue from somebody else, but I don't know who it was. When they're getting into the age where they're starting to use computers for calculating, so they could do billions of calculations in a day instead of in a year, they realize that. And they start to say, let's just, you know, he's got to be 3000 BCE. We can reverse engineer when. Let's do a birth time rectification for Krishna. And so they come up with this different chart. That is decidedly not the traditionally accepted chart for Krishna. So it's going to also break your brain a little bit. If you go out looking for Krishna's chart, you're going to have person A say, hey, look, it looks like this. And then you're going to have persons B, C, and D say, no, it looks like this. And that's the reason why. The thing that people need to realize, what is that? Avajananti mam mudhaja manushim tanum ashrita. That it's, Krishna said in the Gita, it would be foolish to think that my avatar is subject to the same conditions as a human birth. And so, in fact, when avatars appear, and when we get to this sixth canto, sixth book of Bhagavatam, you'll see this. They literally say, when avatars appear, planets go retrograde when they're not supposed to. Planets move to places where they want to be, where the divine wants them to be, not where they're heading. They move off their pattern, and then they return to their pattern. So that is asking a lot for somebody with a science mind and a computer to accept, but that would be the explanation for why this chart, which is astronomically not obtainable, has been accepted for centuries. All right. So let's try to go forward, though, and see what we can know about this chart. So let's start like this. There's one more thing that we know about Krishna. There's one more thing. We also know that he was born at midnight. And again, that's not from the little quote that I read you, but it's from other Puranas. We know that the birth was at midnight. So you have this bit of information. You know that it's a half waning moon in Rohini. So therefore, you know the sun is probably in Purva Palguni. And you know that it's definitely 90 degrees away from the moon. Or within 10-ish degrees of that. And you know that he was born at midnight. If you tell me that it's midnight, then I can tell you where the sun is. I can put the sun on a chart. Right? Like, if you tell me it's sunrise, then I would be an idiot not to put the sun in the first house. It means I have no idea what the first house is. If you tell me that it's sunrise, then I know that the sun is here. If you tell me that it's noon, then I know the sun is there. If you tell me that it's sunset, then I know the sun is there. And if you tell me that it's midnight, then I know the sun is there. Now, we also know that they're 90 degrees apart. So if I know the sun is there, well, it's 270 degrees apart, sorry, because it's going to go down. The counting goes down from 4 to 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So if you tell me that the moon is a half moon waning, then I know the moon is there. So guess what else I know? I know that the moon is rising. This makes sense for Krishna. That Rohini moon, that Ashtami Rohini Siddha moon, is on the ascendant. So people knowing this, they've just speculated that it is probably, knowing how beautiful, how love-oriented and romantic and artistic he was, it's probably right on the ascendant. It's probably exactly on the ascendant. So if you're going to put degrees on the things, you probably should do that. Okay? So now you can do first half. Now you can do moon in the first house interpretation. And you can do sun in the fourth house interpretation. Sun in the fourth house interpretation is very interesting. We just looked at these from our Paladipika stream. Sun in the fourth house is a person who sacrifices themselves. They sacrifice their family for some other cause. So at birth, Krishna was, you could say, he sacrificed his family to protect them. And he was separated from his family to protect himself. That's why he was put on a farm somewhere. And then, at adulthood, he sacrificed that family to go back to the original family, the birth family, for the nobility and the noble causes and all that stuff. That's exactly what Paladipika says about sun in the fourth house. Other things that Paladipika didn't say about sun in the fourth house, but that I feel about sun in the fourth house. Sun in the fourth house, people are also very much like, it's compatible with having a waning moon. If you have sun in the fourth house and a waxing moon, it's a little problematic. But if you have sun in the fourth house and a waning moon, then it's synergistic. Because the waning moon is not extroversive and the sun in the fourth house is not extroversive. And it's not dominant. So this is also very compatible with Rohini. To have to be born at midnight with a Rohini moon is very compatible. Because you become very good at having gravity to you and pulling things towards you and attracting and being attractive. So this is extremely, extremely beautiful and attractive. Astrologically, it shows a native who's historically unique in how beautiful they were. Rohini Moon Ashtami rising with the sun in the fourth house as the moon is waning. Yeah, it has to be waning. And that sun is probably, it's in a Palguni. By the way, also, this is interesting. This is for the people that talk about these things with me. So this month would be called Bhadrapada on the calendar. So the reason why it's called Bhadrapada is because the moon should be full. Can you see? The moon should be full here in Bhadrapada. It doesn't often actually happen, but the idealization of it is that the full moon would be the opposite to the sun. So in other words, when they're naming the months in an Indian Vedic calendar, they're naming the months by the moon because the whole orientation of the calendar is around the moon and the stars and the nakshatra. But it's actually dependent upon the position of the sun, but they don't see the sun. But the way that they would know that the sun is in Palguni, for example, is if the full moon is in Bhadrapada. Because the sun is always 180 degrees from the moon if the moon is full. All right, that's a little side note about why these months are named the way they're named. And why it does tend to... And then they add the Adhik Mas. They add things in and they jostle the calendar around to keep the sidereal and tropical calendars aligned. So that sun in Palguni is rainy season, productive season, the season that makes fruits. All right, back to trying to construct. So I gave you a mystical explanation for why the accepted birth chart for Krishna could be acceptable empirically. The mystical explanation is, well, it's God. You can put the planets wherever he wants. If you don't buy that real estate, there's another option for you. Who cares? The purpose of the... If the purpose of the chart is to archaeologically date this person, then we care. But if the purpose is to know about the person, then it will be very interesting to see what a person who knows a lot about this person would say that their chart is. So think about it that way. We have the great Bhagavatam commentator Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur giving acceptance to the chart that I'll show you. And is also proposed or... accepted by Jayadev Goswami, pretty positive, and it goes to Surdas. So these are really big names of people that understood Krishna. And it originates there, I would say. So the other way to look at it is this. Here's how Surdas explained Krishna's personality to people who understood astrological terms. So Surdas is going to apply his Ayanamsha because he's medieval Indian, early medieval Indian. So he's going to say, moon is in Rohini, so I guess it's in Taurus. So he's going to do this. He's going to do that. That's his first step. And since Rohini is basically very identical to Taurus, like in terms of what they actually do, then you're not really off the mark anyway, if you say he has a Taurus moon. So another way of describing Krishna is, here's a Taurus moon person. And that means the sun is in Leo. Which also seems to make sense because the sun has good dignity if it's in Leo. And the moon has great dignity if it's in Taurus. So this seems kind of like understandable and acceptable. Two out of two planets are domicile or exalted. Here's a great person. Then he's going to say some other very interesting things. Now, when I started my YouTube channel, God, when was that? Let me see. December 20th of 2009.
Wow.
So I started it back in December of 2009. The first thing I put on there was just a random interview that somebody did of me. And I don't have that public anymore because it's a little embarrassing. But the second thing that I did was kind of an elaborate, very kind of choreographed, like 12-part series. How many parts are in this? 8-part series about Krishna's chart. So the link to the playlist for that, that's from 2010. That happened in early 2010, February, January, between January and March 2010, I did that. So I'll put a link to that in the description. So after we're done here, if you want more of this and more like some detail, because it's like an 8-part series, you're going to get plenty of detail. But today, let's just go over the essentials. So he does an interesting thing. Surdas. He says that Venus was Multrikona also. So now you have three planets Multrikona. He suggests that. And that is interesting because it puts the first lord in the sixth house, which doesn't seem to match a Rohini moon and all that stuff. Now, one of the things about Krishna that baffles or fascinates historians is that there seems to be two Krishnas. The Krishna that's young adult seems completely different to them. Seems completely different from the Krishna who's adult. Because the one who's pre-adult is living with farmers and doesn't have any really gigantic responsibilities besides milking cows. And the one who is adult goes back to the goes back to the local capital and becomes he becomes active in the ruling family and then very soon becomes a king. So all of a sudden becomes a very different type of person. So this chart is for the whole person that goes over the whole lifetime. So you will see a big split. And, oh my, hang on. We don't have a very important planet on here. Where is it? I know you're here somewhere. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, N. Where are you, Mr. Rahu? Can you see this is funny? Oh, I remember what you did. I remember this. They did this. That silly developer. And they did this. These two planets here, Rahu and Ketu. Surdas suggests that Ketu belongs here. Which I accept very much because it also means that Rahu goes here. Naughty, naughty. Look at that Rahu. That is a naughty Rahu in Scorpio, the seventh house. And that Ketu up there in Taurus also very much explains a lot. But the reason why I segued into this at this point is because this explains this very dramatic shift. The whole nature of his life is very dramatic shift. It's very hard. He's not actually, even the bhaktas and the yogis say that he's not the same person after he leaves the farms. That part of him, that the true part of himself, stays back in the farm, and then just the external avatar goes out. So there's a big split, and that's very consonant with having a very dominant nodal axis. So Surdas says that the nodal axis is on the ascendant. So this means a couple of interesting things. This means the moon is conjoined Ketu. Now, take that beautiful Rohini Ashtami moon that is just so sexy it's hard to deal with it, and put it with Ketu. Now it has a whole new level, very compatible with it being waning. Now it's on this deep level. It's not some silly fool trying to be sexy. It's some kind of internal stuff going on that makes him that way. And he's not demonstrative. It's super Krishna now. Now super Krishna pulling, attracting. You have the sun in the fourth house. You have a waning moon. And you have Ketu with the waning moon. With Rohini Ashtami. This describes him to a T. The other interesting thing now is, does this... No, it doesn't. It doesn't do that. Okay, now going back to the first lord in the sixth house, that's interesting. So, the first lord in the sixth house is a combative person. A person who deals with problems and enemies all the time. This is accurate for Krishna. Even though he's a flute player and a peacock feather wearer and a dancer and a cow herder, he's a badass that kicks everybody's ass all the time. The king from the capital nearby continuously tries to assassinate him. And he continuously wrecks every assassin. And these assassins are not Joe Schmo. These assassins are like the... If you did the whole thing as an anime, they're like the super ninjas. And the wizards and all these weird black magic ninjas coming to assassinate with him. And he's just like flicking them off with his pinky. And then, of course, after he goes back to Dwarka, Mathura Dwarka, and he becomes a king, he's just like wrecking anybody that comes against him. So that is also consonant with the first lord in the sixth house in this huge dignity of being Multrikona. You don't know degrees, so you can't say what's his Navamsha, what's his this. I mean, you're asking a lot even to just know what's his 12 house thing. We're just going on whatever Surdas explained. He didn't say degrees. So we don't know degrees, but I would assume the moon is on the ascendant and Ketu is super close. And I would assume that all these planets, I would put all of them into degrees where they get high Vaisheshikamsa. Where they get really good dignity by virtue of being in a lot of good amshas. You could engineer the degrees. I think I may have done that in that video, that series of videos. But the other interesting thing, so, and then on the other hand, of the first lord in the sixth house, that's one thing, but it's not Mars as the first lord in the sixth house, or Sun as the first lord in the sixth house, or Saturn as the first lord in the sixth house. It's Venus as the first lord in the sixth house, Libra. So even in his way of dispatching the enemies was never brutal or barbaric. It was always artful and sophisticated and kind of like dancing. In fact, one of my favorite stories is of Krishna dancing on a Tiamat type of a figure. There was a Naga with multiple heads who had come to his pasture area called Vraj and was poisoning the river inadvertently because dragons are toxic. And Krishna was telling him to go, and he didn't want to go, so Krishna got into a fight with him. And the way that he fought him was by dancing on his heads. And when you dance, in Vedic dance, the foot hits the floor pretty hard, often because it's kicking out a beat. So that's how he kicked his head in, by dancing on it. So that's like first lord in the sixth house, Venus, as Venus in Libra. But on top of that, Surda says that Saturn was exalted. So there you go. Saturn in the sixth house, there's not a better spot for it. Perhaps Saturn in the third is a little bit better. But Saturn is now in its ideal spot. It is exalted and in its prime house, in the house that it functions best in. And guess what, ladies and gentlemen? If you keep this chart and you say Taurus is the ascendant, then Saturn is Yogacaraka. It owns 9 and 10. And Venus is Yogacaraka. It owns 1. So you have a union or a yoga of the two Yogacarakas, the first lord and the Yogacaraka, the 9th and 10th lord. So this is uber steroidal Raj Yoga. Steroidal is a bad choice of words in relation to Krishna. But uber mega Raja Yoga. Uber mega Raja Yoga in the sixth house. Undefeatable. Unassailable. So we have three planets left that are unplaced. And I believe he said exaltations for Mars and Mercury. So let's do Mercury first. This is also very interesting. Can you get a better spot for Mercury than this? Mercury is in Virgo in the fifth house. Did you get, like, is there a smarter person? The other thing is, I don't know how well Surdas knew astrology, but or if this is a divine revelation or what, but this is really accurate. But like, the other thing that comes up is now he has, there's a lot of maximum brightness going on here. So Mercury is at maximum brightness and Venus is at maximum brightness. This is a significant thing that astrologers who know the details like this, they look out for that. How separated or bunched are Mercury and Venus to the Sun? The more they separate, the more auspicious it is. So he's got Venus is at maximum distance from the Sun and Mercury is also at maximum distance from the Sun. It doesn't get better for Venus and Mercury. And the Sun is in Leo. It doesn't get better for any of these planets. Like, how could you... It's just like a puzzle that just all fits together. How awesome all of these placements is. I think Surdas just took that statement of Paramashobhana, that everything was in its, or Sarva Gunopetya, everybody had its high dignity and everything was blessed, and figured out how it could have been. Then you take, he said Mars was exalted, so that means Mars here. Wow, what? Mars in the ninth house exalted. The person is dharmic. The person fights for morals, but it's Mars. So they have their own... They don't really follow the standard textbook. Everything that they do is moral and good, but it's not really going to be typical. And believe me, this guy here, Rahu in the seventh house, with a Rohini moon on an Ashtami day, you're not going to see, he is not going to be a celibate. Let's put it that way. And then finally, the other planet, which is in its own sign, is Jupiter here. The significance of this is also fairly vast, because it puts Jupiter and Mercury into mutual alignment. So the intelligence is amazing. The significance also is the 11th house has its own lord in it. This is how you got, so put that with a Rohini moon, Palguni sun, Ashtami, and you can see the musicianship and the artistry is phenomenal. In mutual aspect with the fifth lord in the fifth house, the musicianship, the comprehension of culture and sophistication is unparalleled. Also, when you put Mars and Saturn into their exaltation, then the person is not a brute. Those things become in good dignity. Those brute forces of Mars and Saturn, they're now in good dignity. They don't misbehave. And the other thing about this Jupiter is now it's going to aspect potentially the third house cusp, but it's definitely going to, or we don't know the degrees, but it looks like it's going to aspect Rahu in the fifth house. So it's going to modify it a little bit to make it wholesome, but it's going to also just make it like those just like really rich chocolate, like really rich enjoyment. The eighth, just wrap your head around this, the eighth lord is in its own sign in the 11th house, aspecting and being aspected by the intelligence of Mercury from the fifth and sophistication of Mercury from the fifth exalted, while aspecting Rahu in the seventh house in Scorpio for a person with a Rohini moon, which is also aspecting Rahu in the seventh house in Scorpio. That is melted chocolate on a strawberry. The other that's the chart, ladies and gentlemen. And there's just one other fascinating thing about this is you think, God damn, that chart is perfect. But it's not perfect. There's never a perfect chart. Put your first lord in the sixth house, even with great dignity and Raja Yogas and everything, it's still a little bit tiring. You have to deal with problems and enemies all the time. The other thing that is less than, also to have the Rahu and Ketu that exalted is not stable, so there's a lot of ups and downs and upheavals and big events. For him, it's great. It makes him life very exciting. The other thing about the chart that is an eye catcher in terms of it not being ideal is, anybody see a particular yoga here which is not a desirable yoga? For the most part, there is no undesirable yoga in this chart, except for one. Anybody see it? It is Kamadruma. This is a Kamadruma moon. Now, we talked about that. I mean, that's one thing, but the yoga. This is Kamadruma yoga of a moon with Ketu. So this is And this Kamadruma yoga, did you notice something else about the chart? There's nothing in the Kendras. Of the five actual planets, they're not in the Kendras. In the central houses, the pink houses on this chart, there's just the nodes, which aren't even planets. And there's the moon, which is a luminary. And there's the sun. So in terms of being able to modify the Kamadruma yoga, there is nothing. So he's got a very dramatically pronounced Kama Dharma Yoga. The effect of the Kama Dharma Yoga is sudden loss of positions due to disinterest or disconnect from them. This you'll, if you look at the historics of his life, you'll see this in a moment of birth, where he has to be evacuated for political reasons and live, not see his father or mother, biological father or mother, for like, I think it was 13 earth years, but in terms of his development, it's like 18. And then make all those relationships with everybody there. Have a mother and a father who raised you, have friends, have girlfriends, have everything there, and then get pulled back into your royal life. You have to leave that. Then you have to leave your family city because everybody is out for blood against you, so you don't want to have them under threat. So he goes and lives out in the ocean. He didn't even live on the mainland. He made a fortress off the coast. And then you just decide, and you're dealing with these huge upheaval events like Mahabharata war and all this stuff. And then you just decide, all right, it's done. 120 years old and it's done. And then you just get yourself shot in the foot by Archer, and then you give up everything on that. So it's very, very, very illustrative of Kama Dharma in the way it makes a person participate. It's an odd juxtaposition to have this Rohini Ashtami native with a Kama Dharma to the moon. And it's very important to understand Krishna. His sensuality is apex. It's beyond the people that we think are really good party people. It's beyond the Picassos. It's beyond the Michael Jacksons, who we think are very creative and beautiful. It's beyond. But it's not exactly fully here. And that is in the waning moon, and then the sun in the fourth, and then the K2 with the moon, and then with this Kama Dharma moon, it really tops it off. It's not fully invested into this plane of existence that we are fully invested into. It's fully invested into some internal thing, and it's only temporarily or conditionally expressed into our realm. So that's the chart. Pretty interesting. No, more than pretty interesting, but hopefully I did a interesting evaluation of it. So it's kind of interesting how we can get from this to this, kind of just by extrapolating upon a simple four-line statement, which really just said, actually we have to bring in some other one or two lines from other Puranas to be able to get something that makes this verifiable. So there's two reasons why I find that this is a verifiable chart, and I kind of laugh at the B.V. Raman chart, the one that's in the Notable Horoscopes book. The first reason is I spent a bit of time studying Krishna, and this is Krishna. This chart is Krishna. But the other, that's just my subjective thing. But the objective thing is, this one conforms with the information that we do have in the Puranas. It doesn't break or contradict them. It provides information which is not there, but the information which is provided that's not there is not inconsistent with or contradictory to the information that is there. Therefore, this one is acceptable. not to speak of. I mean, every individual gives a lot of importance to their own subjectivity, but also you have acharyas of Krishna Bhakti, Surdas, Jayadev. I believe Jayadev mentions this horoscope, and Vishnu Chakravarti. The reason I say Vishnu Chakravarti is in Vishwanath's commentary on this third text from the, is it the third text? On this first text from the third chapter of the 10th book of Bhagavatam, he gives this chart. And he says this is what Surdas explained as the chart. All right, folks, any questions? Lord of the Ascendant and the Six with an Exalted Saturn. The Lord of this, his appearance, first of all, is mostly determined by the moon being on the Ascendant in Rohini. Then the first Lord is with Exalted Saturn. Just like I said, if you have Mars and Saturn are the brutes, the ugly, hard, heavy features. If they are in dignity, then those things do not cause any problems. Those things don't come up. So just like the personality of a person with Mars and Saturn in high dignity is not violent and not aggressively negative. In the same way, a person with Mars and Saturn in good dignity is good looking. So remember, just as Pramana proof, just look at Paul Deepika's explanation of Saturn in a third. He says, beautiful, sweet, loving. Mars in a third, good-looking, beautiful. Mars in the sixth, good-looking. When you put these planets in good conditions, then the things, the difficult things they represent don't cause you problems. So when you have the first Lord in Libra, in the sixth house with the exalted Saturn, you can't find a trace of ugliness. Especially if the Rohini moon is on the ascendant. The other thing is, I don't know, he's so good. This chart is so good. This might be a divine revelation, to be honest, like of this chart to Surdas, because it's so accurate. The other thing is, think about where the aspects of the malefics are going. Just go ahead and look at that for right now. They're not really going anywhere. Mars is aspecting Aries, Cancer, and Leo. So the Sun is getting some aspect from Mars. That's nice. They're the same type of planet. They're the same type. They represent the same type of things. Saturn is aspecting Sagittarius, Aries, and Cancer. There's nobody there. And so the two of them, Mars and Saturn, are aspecting the 12th house. I bet you there's a focal point there. I bet you they're aligned. They have a huge influence in the 12th house. Whereas compare it with Jupiter and Jupiter's aspects and Mercury's aspects. Even Venus's aspects to the 4th and the 8th, which are non-negligible aspects, is strongly influencing Mars and it's strongly influencing the moon. This is a good one thing about putting the first Lord in the sixth house is that it will benefit the first house. Most likely. When you know degrees, then you can check for sure and you can see how much. But when you don't know degrees, you can just say generically that it will aspect the first house when it's in the sixth. Because every planet has 3/4 of an aspect to its 8th and 4th. Any other questions? Julian asks if the chart has ever repeated himself. Go back and watch from the beginning, or watch the thing that's in the linked in the description. I explained that the chart not only has never repeated itself, it never occurred. You can't find this chart. If you do, if you get a software that's capable of research, like Astro Gold, I forget what that, maybe that's not the correct name for it. You can search, you can get 18 CPUs on this and search all year long, and you're not going to find this. No, I don't think you should do Aries Ascendant. This is not a chart that actually occurred. That's what I'm saying. I think you would want to do Aries Ascendant because you would put Rohini there by Ayanamsa. But don't, this is not an astronomical chart. This is a chart from another world. It didn't happen at a particular point in time. Okay, guys. Trines, grand trines. I think you could get a grand trine of Earth. We don't know the degrees, so you can speculate that maybe there's a grand. I mean, this would be useful to do research. You could figure out. You can figure out, but you could hypothesize the degrees of the charts by doing things like that. Like, what degree would Mars be at where it would have the highest Vaishesha Kamsha, like the best subdivisions of its sign, but also remain in alignment with Mercury and Moon so that it can form a grand trine of Earth to the Ascendant, which would be fabulous, right? A grand trine of Earth to the Ascendant, like Liz Taylor or something, comes to mind. I think hers is water, grand trine to the Ascendant, but it's one of those beauty elements, earth or water. All right, that was very awesome. Thank you for your company, and I hope you have a great Krishna Janmashtami, and I hope that this year you spend a little bit more time in the Bhagavatam stream that I do once a week. And it's, what is it, Wednesday on the East Coast? So that you can learn more about Krishna. Thank you.